by MTN, and I still have Pastor Ichua Ighodalo in the house, and we're having a very robust discussion. Right, we were talking about what you think is best for our country, and you mentioned quite a number of things. But look at the current scenario that we have. What would you say is the underlying problem? Where lies the real problem? I'd like you to hit the nail on the head. What are we doing wrong as we speak? You know, what is the underlying problem that we have?
Well, I think Nigeria's underlying problem is out of a bit of fear and ignorance, especially by the people who have found themselves or who force themselves or who push themselves into power. The reason why a lot of these people put themselves into power was primarily for their own sake, and secondly for the sake of the tribal or the religious interest that they represent. And that really is the biggest challenge of Nigeria. When a man goes into governance without a vision, without an idea, without a sense of responsibility as to what he's supposed to do for the betterment of the people that he's presiding over, and when all he's thinking about is cornering as much of the natural or the Commonwealth resource for himself and for his group of people, then you really sincerely have a problem.
And we do have that kind of attitude across the board, unfortunately.
That is a primary and predominant attitude.
Yes.
And because of that, a lot of people are shortchanged for various reasons, and they will tend to complain. They will tend to react. They will tend to fight back. They will tend to say, this is not what we bargained for. So, and this is really the main crux of the problem in Nigeria from different sectors. And everybody is a little bit guilty of the same thing. And that's why we talk about federal character. That's why we talk about religious balancing. That's why we talk about this and that and the other one. Because all the thinking, all the policies are towards sharing and appropriating resource not towards creating resource and making more resource available for the Commonwealth.
But then who's going to bail the cat? Are we going to go back to the British colonialists? Who's going to bail the cat of reform? Because if almost all of us are guilty of the same thing, do you think that maybe when our backs are completely against the wall, our eyes will open to the realities of the mess that we are in?
Maybe that is what is happening. Maybe you have to get your back completely to the wall, like it happened in France with the French Revolution. Like it happened in Russia with the Bolshevik Revolution. Like it happened even in the United States in the Civil War. The Civil Wars of America were based on something similar to this. So maybe until you really get your back to the wall and you find that everybody's under frustration, both the rich and the poor, the haves and the have-nots and everything, then maybe we now need to sit around a table and say there must be a better way.
Because it doesn't look too good, does it, Ito?
No, not at the moment.
It doesn't
because
look too
it's
good.
Become more and more depressing. It's gotten worse and worse because a few people who had the privilege seem to have gotten away with that privilege. And they've kept on pushing the barriers, kept on pushing the borders, kept on pushing the borders until it has now become very, very frightening. And the whole thing is now showing up itself. Initially, it was subtle. People didn't quite understand it. They didn't quite know what was going on. But now, what has happened is that this government has been able to really expose everything.
Everything.
And a lot more people are getting a lot more knowledgeable about exactly what is going on.
But do you see a central hand in all these things that are happening? Sometimes government wants to make it look as if, oh, it's certain persons that are doing this, excuse me, for this or that. Or do you think that the various incidents we have, security-wise, are spontaneous? Well, let me tell you what I believe.
Okay,
so I mean, we can have a well-rounded discussion. I believe that they are spontaneous. I believe one or two might be planned somewhat, but I believe that the others are spontaneous, especially with the young people. Especially, not, it doesn't exonerate the older people, but especially with the young people, people are suffering. And I think people have gotten to a point where they don't add too much value to their lives anymore anyway. And therefore, my theory is that if we don't do something very quickly, it could get really, really worse.
I think I agree with you. One or two are orchestrated and planned, okay?
Yes.
By some people with political intent, with the divisiveness and things like that.
Mm.
Normally, in any society, you find that of planning and that kind of strategy. But what is happening now, and I agree with you, especially the NSAS, you know, I'm not NSAS, I'm 60. I don't know how it started, but looking at what happened, I think it was just a pure spontaneous reaction. So the government trying to see if there was some kind of undertone and some hand behind it, I think is a total waste of time. I think some people just, I mean, it's like the Arab Spring that happened a few years ago, where a man in frustration just set fire to himself and said, what nonsense.
He couldn't have planned it.
He didn't plan it. Who would plan to set fire to himself? Except, of course, he was paid by somebody.
Paid, yes. Right.
So some child was killed somewhere. And some children just said, enough. And as they said enough, some other children echoed it, and some other children echoed it. And before you knew it, you had some movement. And sometimes this is exactly how these things start. They're not really premeditated. You know, something just happens, you know, and sparks off the whole thing.
I always make an analogy that people shouldn't think that things like this will be like a football game when you have kickoff, then you have halftime. No, it's not going to be like that. It could go on if care is not taken for years. In fact, what frightens me is what happened to countries like Somalia when the whole structure broke down. There was no central government, no central currency, nothing. And you had warlords. Nigeria is gradually moving in that direction, and it's very, very frightening. But of course, we're all critical of the response of the top to this crisis. I'm one of those who believe that the president could play more of a leading role. He could comfort people, you know, by speaking to them and trying to quell things. He doesn't think he needs to do that, obviously. And many other things that you would expect would have been done at that level. We look like a ship whose rudder is completely broken and the captain has fainted. I mean, you don't get it worse on a high sea, you know. The rudder is broken, the captain has fainted, you're just being tossed, you know, like a bobby. And if anyone has a sense of history, if anybody has a sense of history, I keep maintaining, I was relatively old enough and aware to know where things were going when the Civil War started, even though I was a very young chap. But this is how gradually, I was telling you and my supervisor, I was telling you that the Nigerian Civil War, it didn't start as a war. It started as a police action. Kamal said, go and arrest Oduku. Which we thought, naively, maybe because I was very young, we thought, okay, this will be over within a week. They'll just go to government house and grab him out. See, it stretched for four years plus. We should even be glad that war ended.
Mm.
But has the war actually ended? It hasn't.
I'm not sure it has.
It hasn't.
Not completely.
It hasn't.
The embers are still there.
The fight, the physical fighting is gone, yeah. But the embers are still there.
The embers are still there.
Now, any child that was born during the war, today is a full-grown adult, was a baby then, today is a full-grown adult, still tells you about the war as if he was alive then.
The embers are still
so there. So we do need to be very, very careful. But you don't see an urgency at the top. Rather, what you see is accusations being thrown. By the way, I hope I'm safe enough to have you here because it has been said that some pastors are planning something. I hope you're not one of them.
No pastor is planning.
I'm not planning anything with you, Israel. No. If you're one of them, let us end this thing now. Make everybody bear in Papa's name.
No pastor is planning. The pastors don't have the capacity to plan anything.
No, the thinking from, you know, was that, and that they would declare a vote of no confidence. And my reaction was that any group of people can get together and declare a vote of no. Maybe you should call a lawyer.
Maybe you should call a lawyer. But no pastor, I can assure people that no pastor is planning anything. Pastors are just echoing what they feel their congregants are saying. You know, a lot of congregants are looking at pastors and saying to them that give us direction, give us inspiration, give us encouragement. What is going on? What is God saying? What should we do? We are feeling the pain.
You tell me, what is God saying?
What is God saying? You know,
He spoke to you.
God speaks, and God speaks to everybody. The challenge is learning how to hear from God.
Hear from God.
You know, And usually, if you go to the Bible, you see incidences like this that have happened before and how God sort of reacted to it. What God is saying clearly to me is that it is time for people to draw closer to God. Because, you know, a lot of people think only God can solve this problem.
Yes.
And I'm beginning to fall into that category also. But I also believe that God will also want people to do something and meet him halfway. You know, for as long as people stay and the acceptance of accepting of where they are, God will say that's fine. But when the people of Israel, they were in bondage under Egypt many, many years ago, about 4,000 years ago, roughly, they were in bondage and happily they were there for about 400 years. And then in about the 350th year, they began to cry to God. In lamentation that you work for you, is this not enough? We can't breathe, we can't move, we're under poverty, blah blah blah. And what the Bible says that God heard their cry, he heard their cry, and he began to move a few.
But also in the Old Testament, at some point, you know, you use the phrase, let my people go.
Yes,
and at some point, when Pharaoh said he wasn't going to let them go, what did God do? He hardened his heart.
Yes.
Is that what we're having now? We'll take a short break and then we'll be right back.
The Discourse with Jimmy Disco. The Discourse with Jimmy
MTN Pulse, do you dial *406# to join? Everywhere you go, MTN.
And now we are back on the Discourse with Jimmy Disson.
Hey, welcome back. Thus saith the Lord. You thought I would quote something. No, I'm not going to quote
Pastor Jimmy. Pastor Jimmy.
But I asked you, I said in the Bible, you know, when, you know, because you use the word, let my people go. So obviously you do feel that people are in bondage. But and I asked that in the Bible, it was said that when God said to Pharaoh, let my people go, and he didn't go, he hadn't. hardened the heart of Pharaoh.
Mm-hmm. That's dangerous, Jimmy.
That's very dangerous.
Very dangerous. Because when God does that, he hardens for destruction. And what happened to Pharaoh was that the next thing, he was destroyed.
Well, we hope nobody is destroyed in all this.
That is why I say it's dangerous. The issue is for Pharaoh to quickly let the people go. And it's to everybody's benefit that
I think, correct me if I'm wrong, let me speak on your behalf. I think Pharaoh here, it doesn't refer to one person as such. It refers to all the political gangsters out there who have held us in bondage.
And the spirit behind them, because there's a spirit behind it also.
You see, we are in sync, we're in spirit. I should be a pastor.
You are already a pastor.
You should allow me to come and preach a sermon one day in your church.
You are most welcome. Anytime. Just tell me when. It's good for you. Maybe before your next break.
Don't let me talk about 10-15 minutes.
No problem.
People will be shocked.
It would be nice. You know, that's the kind of refreshing and refreshment we need, even in the body. And you'll be surprised where wisdom comes from.
Because people, of course, most people don't know that I'm a Christian, but it's just that what else needs to find its own level. Let's leave that one. We're not talking about myself here. Now, what do we do in reality as a people? What kind of pressure do we need to exert? Because we do need to put these people under pressure. I heard that there was a senator that was crying, you know, on the floor of the Senate. And I think that the gentleman was crying out of fear. The reality has hit him. Because he still didn't come out with anything that they would sacrifice. You know, I thought that, okay, after you said all this and whatever, I said, let's start by doing this and doing that and doing that. He never said anything like that. And so how do we exert? We need to exert pressure. I stand to be corrected on that. We need to exert pressure on these people so that the right things can be done. We can't continue like this. There's no point deceiving ourselves by saying everything is okay in Nigeria. It is not.
It is not. It is definitely
not. It is not. It is definitely not. And even the future. Okay, so because we would say that, okay, let's see what we can just manage and steady the boat till 2023. Mm-hmm. But here you are. You called out Tinubu, for example, mm-hmm. in your 60th birthday, mm-hmm. whatever. And mm-hmm. Why did you call him out? You don't think he should run?
He's my friend, and we're quite close. I mean, at least we used to be.
Why? What do you mean used to be?
Well, we're quite close. I haven't seen him for some time. I'm intending to see him as soon as I can, so that we can have a closer conversation. Tinubu has done some really great things, I must confess.
Yes.
He's been able to charge up Lagos. Mm. He's also been able to identify talent, you know.
Okay, yes.
And allow talent, you know. He's identified quite a lot of people, mm-hmm. and he has allowed them to come into their own and all that and all that. So he's done phenomenally well mm-hmm. in that area. He's a brave and courageous man.
Yes.
Very, very interested to some extent in the people, but to a larger extent in himself. This is where the challenge is. Okay. Hmm. The second thing is that a lot of the people that he groomed and developed, they have become big boys, and he's not recognizing that they are big boys. He has to allow them to be big boys and allow them to negotiate with him at a table. Okay. You know, when your child is 2 years old, there's a way you treat the child.
Yes.
When
yes.
the child is 18, there's a way you treat the child. Someone here about the firewood, so to the game day. There's a difference where you treat the child. You now sit around the table and you have a conversation, but you don't stop being their father.
Yes.
They will always refer to you as father. At 2 years old, you give them instructions. At 18, you begin to have conversations, but a bit of instruction. But at 26 and 30,
you
have
to
conversations and you negotiate. And at the end of the day, you allow them to argue. And when they finish arguing, they say, let's go to daddy. Let daddy decide, and daddy now decides. Mm-hmm. Eventually, your opinion and your view gets carried, but not by enforcement.
So in this sense, you think that he should give younger people a chance?
He should give younger people a chance.
I think so, too.
And they should come back to him for the casting vote, okay? And if they then decide that it is him that they want, no problem.
But he could argue that that has been done.
Not quite. I think what I'm a bit concerned about is the way by which he's pushing himself forward. And I don't think that is the role he should be playing. Mm. I think the role he should be playing now is gathering all the people at the minimum in the Southwest together and says, come, let's all have a discourse. What is in the best interest, first of all, of Nigeria and the secondary of the Southwest? How do we push our best foot forward? How do we make sure that we have a robust economy in the Southwest? How do we make sure we have a robust economy in Lagos? How do we make sure that everybody in the Southwest is lifted up? And if we want to compete at the center, what is our best foot forward?
Now, okay, talking about best foot forward for, let's say, the West that you use as an example, let's play a bit of a game here. Throw you under the table a bit. Name three people in the West that you think could be one of the three that we could put forward. Because when we say these things, then we definitely must have certain persons in mind. I can name my three, but you name your three first.
Well, you know, when we say the West or the Southwest, people of Southwestern descent.
Descent,
and
yes.
background.
Yes. Okay.
Fashola did a good job.
Yes, that's
as
mine.
As governor of Lagos State.
That's my first
There's
one.
No doubt. He's not done as well as
minister yes.
I am there. There may be different reasons. I think personally that he's still scarred from the political experience he went through in Lagos. Secondly, he maybe has limited authority and autonomy and power. And thirdly, maybe he's balancing the politics of the federal.
The federal,
okay.
Yes.
But in Lagos, he did a phenomenal job as governor. He worked 24/7. He thought through everything and so on and so forth. So I would say that he's quite a good contender for that pushing, if you like, your best foot forward.
Second name?
There are a few other people, they're more like technocrats, okay? They may not quite be...
In the Fashola mold.
In the Fashola mold and so on and so forth. But quite a few young, not so young Lagosians have run some very, very credible businesses and institutions.
So who are you thinking of?
We could think of one or two of them. If a guy like Aigu Mokwede, for instance, was a Lagosian or was from the West.
Yes, from the West.
Yes. He's done a reasonably good job.
But he has no political experience. You see, that is where my...
Neither did Fashola, by the way.
Yes,
I don't know
what you
mean by political experience.
No, he hasn't he hasn't handled public office. And I don't think that...
Well, Fashola hadn't handled public office before.
But he had this other gentleman behind to tackle all the political...
That's why we put them behind. That's why... Tinubu should come behind and argue more questions.
You know, that's why I don't agree with Obasanjo about his choice of Adesina or whatever it is. This Africa ADB gentleman, he could be all the technocrats in the world, but the question is, can you pull the trigger?
What do you mean the trigger?
No, when I say trigger, I mean, when I say trigger is, can you... Nigeria is a tough country. So you must be somebody who can stand his own against all the political shenanigans. And that's where I believe that it's good that you have, to the barest minimum, maybe you've run a state. I'm thinking of somebody like Fayemi.
Fayemi is not bad. Fayemi has a bit of balance.
Intellectual. And so on and so forth. And he's also a student of history.
So we really do have,
but I'm one of those who believe that, for God's sake, it would be nice if we could all agree to let's have somebody from the East run this country so that we can have a full balance.
I will go for Obi any day, Peter Obi.
Peter Obi.
Yeah. I think he's done quite a good job. There are a few other technocrats too from the East who have done reasonably well that we can go for. If the East themselves will line up behind somebody, one of the challenges of the Easterners is that they have no king. And they don't think anybody is good enough.
But it's not in their culture. It's the Oyinbos that gave them kings way back in the day.
It's not in their culture. So if the Easterners too could come together, you know what El Rufai said?
Yeah, like I was good to that on your program.
Like it or love it was a little bit correct to some extent. He said in a very hard and caustic way, and maybe with a bit of arrogance, no doubt. But it's practical, okay? First of all, the Easterners have to line up behind somebody. They refuse to line up behind somebody. And I have challenged them that who are you lining up behind? They will refuse to line up behind somebody. And I've also said to them, they don't even need Nigeria. They have enough resource among themselves.
To develop themselves.
What are they waiting for federal for? They are rich people. Some Igbo friend of mine said to me that 70% of them are wealthy. What are they doing with that wealth? You go to the East, they have big, huge mansions everywhere. But no roads leading to the mansions. What does that mean? I was going to say, who does that?
Who does that? All right.
Who does that?
Our lines are open now. We'll be taking calls 0700-993-993-993. The female line is 0146571190. Now, when you do call in, these are the rules. Number one, switch off your radio. You can't listen to radio and listen to yourself. No, that's not going to happen. Secondly, call from a quiet place. And let's respect ourselves, okay? If you disagree with what has been said, let's watch our language. Right? So I'll take the first caller. Male or female? Okay. All right. Hello, good morning.
Hello, sir, Uncle Jimmy.
Morning, sir.
Yeah, this is Pastor Ladipo.
Yes, sir.
Calling from
Olura, definitely. Yes. We know you.
Good morning, my pastor, sir.
Morning, Pastor Ladipo.
Well, my take this morning is for us, sir. If, like Uncle Jimmy said, we can balance this thing and give the instanas a chance. Secondly, sir, what I want to say is, what Pastor Ido Itua is doing, if others can also be speaking up, either from other religious bodies, I think these people will now begin to realize themselves. But the situation whereby we continue to paint them and tell them it is well, and others decide to stay aloof, it will not help us. Thank you, sir, and God bless Nigeria.
All right, thank you. Hello, good morning.
Morning, sir.
Morning.
Morning, Pastor.
Morning.
Adegoke from Lekki.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, my concern today is, like the caller, last caller said, about pastors, GOs of churches. It takes me back to when Archbishop Benson Idahuza was still alive. Then he was a bold man, and even though in the military era, confronted Abacha. I remember then growing up, he confronted Abacha if Abacha was doing the wrong thing. You know, and in the Bible, it was a set example that prophets were people who actually even were more closer to the kings then. And the kings consulted them for whatever decisions they wanted to take back then. What is the role of the GOs right now that we have? Is it because I see that many of them are concerned about their church alone, like four walls of the church?
Okay. And, Thank you.
So what?
All right. Ita, you want to react to that?
Yeah. Not a problem at all. I think the first one who spoke, the gentleman, I can't remember his name, says people should speak up a bit more. And definitely we should give the Igbos a chance. Definitely, I agree that it's time for somebody from the East.
I think it will provide some kind of healing.
It will.
Yes.
But I think still there's a bit of apprehension of this. Maybe when the Igbos come, they will now try and reverse everything that the Northerners have tried to do and all that. But we should take the risk.
We took the risk with this gentleman anyway.
The Igbos are Nigerians. But the Igbos themselves must gather themselves together, come up with one front, or offer 3-4 people, and let the general populace decide on which one of them, and line up behind the people and show that they're willing. And like El-Rufai says, be willing to negotiate with the rest of Nigeria.
El-Rufai, we know, also has his eyes on the presidency at some point. What kind of a president do you think he might be? He's a bit brash, isn't he?
He's a bit brash, no doubt, but he's very, very of deep intellectual capacity.
Oh, yes, yes.
He's also a developmental person. When he was in the Federal Capital Territory, he did a good job.
Yes.
Stepped on a few toes, but he sanitized the place. Okay, in Kaduna State now, he's doing quite a lot in terms of infrastructure, in terms of education.
Well, how do you react to his reaction, you know, saying that he was ready to lose some of those children rather than pay a ransom?
That was very, very military.
Don't you think it was a bit tactless?
It was a bit military, but that's El-Rufai for you. He tells you as he sees it. And that is what has helped, that is what has managed to dent and damage a lot of his image, you know. Some other person wouldn't have said it quite like that. You know, would have said it more like, we're going to use every power that we have, and by God's grace, all will be well. You know, he would not have tried to emphasize that there may be collateral damage. But he said it because he's thought about it.
Yeah, but because you're talking of kids, really.
My
prescription is that pay the ransom, but make sure you take all those guys down.
Okay, that's a compromise.
Pay a ransom, get the kids, and make sure
go after them.
And I don't think it is too much for a... one thing, anybody who has any dealing with Americans, for example, knows that if you run foul of their laws or whatever, they will take you down. If it takes you 20 years. And I think that's the kind of determination and the kind of thing he should have said. Rather, you're talking of kids here.
I think you've said a very wise thing.
Yes.
In that, you know what? Pay the ransom.
Pay the ransom.
But it doesn't stop there.
And take
then
them
go
down.
After them.
Go after them.
After you have rescued those kids safely.
Yes.
Then go after them to teach everybody else a
lesson.
You won't get away with it. You won't have a chance to do this a second time.
And what some countries do is sometimes if it gets so bad, you contract out the whatever, sign an executive order and take... I think it was Hillary Clinton asked one question about, I can't remember what it said, wipe them off the face of the earth.
Mm. I think what you said is a good compromise.
See, how did Buhari become my hero? I will tell you.
Mm.
I don't know if I've told this story. You remember what happened to Dicko?
Umaru Dicko. Yes.
When everybody thought that all the money that the MPN had embezzled was
in his
him.
Hands, yes.
They put him in a crate and we're going to bring him down here. We were all jubilating.
Put him in a crate.
Yes.
Put him in a crate.
That's kind of action. But to say that I don't care if some of the children die, no, I think it was a bit
tactless,
which means that he might not have the total whatever to be. A president has to look at all things.
Yeah.
As it might be a bit too...
Yeah.
I don't want to use the word hot-headed, but...
but you used the word.
I've used the word.
No, but El-Rufai is a very, very competent administrator.
Oh, yes.
He may not be able to effectively manage his politics very well because of his...
But also manage his people. He's a bit too brash.
If
you want to... that's why I say that a president must have very little... political garbage,
baggage.
And that is good that, okay, if somebody could be well, like additional Welsh technocrat, ADB, and so on and so forth. But, hey, that's just 40%. 60% is keeping the country down.
Mm.
And then so you need the contacts, you need the experience, you need so many other things, people skills.
The ability to negotiate.
I can't be a political leader.
Why not?
I'm not disposed to negotiating what I think is what I've already made up my mind is right. If it's a fault, I take it. I'm not disposed for how to make a road to go through this place. I don't care whose house it goes through, in some sort of sense.
Well,
you tell me, I know this is Chief Kiniko, he's a supporter, then it should go an extra 10 miles this way and that. I would say, why? Can't you sacrifice?
Well, negotiation doesn't mean that you take the wrong decisions.
Yes.
Negotiations means that you take every idea on board.
On board.
And you find the right way, or a nice way,
to manipulate.
To taking the right
decision.
But
you see, the truth is, in our political terrain,
you
said it at the very beginning, these people think of themselves only. Are you ever going to go into politics, though?
Well, people ask me that question. Going to politics, what you mean is, am I ever going to
run for elective position? Yes.
It is not in my desire to do so. It is not really...
But if your people call on you, Uncle?
If they call on me, and if it is absolutely what you may call this and that, I will consider it. Not for myself. I don't need anything.
Mm.
Honestly, Jimmy, I am content. I am self-satisfied. I have very little needs. You and I were saying just now, how many shirts do you
have? How many shirts?
Have a headache thinking of what to wear. I told them in my church, don't give me things. You know, somebody brought to me a lovely pen the other day. It was a nice pen, but I have about 10 pens.
What am I going to do with it?
I don't even know how much it costs. Give me the money. There are people whose school fees I need to pay. There are people whose hospital bills I need to pay. There are people whose rent I need to pay. I get 20 calls every day of somebody demanding for something. On my way here, somebody was calling. I didn't pick the call because I knew what they wanted. I wanted to focus on where I was going. I didn't want them to call me and make me sad.
Make you sad, yes.
I wanted to focus on where I'm going. When I finish with you now, I will send them a text and I'll say, what is the problem?
No, it's an alert.
I can tell
don't
you,
send text
they will me. Say 10,000 or 20,000. You know, and they've called me 7 times or 20 times for 7,000 because what government should be doing, government hasn't done. So the pressure is on people like me to do it. So for me, I'm okay. Honestly, I'm happy with my church. I'm happy with
but
being
some,
the people
But some people
in my
still
church.
Say that people of your constituency, on both sides of the religion, are part of the conspiracy that is keeping us down.
I agree because people of my constituency, they are men before they are men of God.
Well,
they are men before they are men of Allah. They themselves are hungry. they themselves have needs. They themselves want to hang out with the high and mighty, the rich and powerful. They want to be friends of this and friends of that. They want the president to come to their mosque or come to their church. They want people to see that I am the president's friend or the governor's friend and all that. And so because of all those human needs and human desires and human aspirations,
it doesn't go away for a pastor and an
doesn't go away for a pastor or anything, you tend to make a few compromises. So for you to do the right thing in Nigeria, it involves a lot of sacrifice. I know the amount of sacrifice I've been able to make for me to be able to stand up and say what I need to say. It's not that all these people are not my friends. They're all my friends, okay? And even as I speak, not all of them are happy with me because of the things that I have said. But I will say what I need to say. My loyalty is first to Nigeria and to the good people of Nigeria than to anybody else, okay? And that's my commitment. When Jonathan was in government, we said these things. It had nothing to do with Jonathan. I like Jonathan as a person, but I didn't like what he was doing.
Were you close to him?
No, not really. But I was close to a lot of people in his government. You know, for the past 20 years, 25 years, there's no government that I've not known serious people.
Serious people. I mean, that's our generation.
That's our generation. There's no government. It's like you becoming governor of Lagos. Then they'll be wondering, am I close to Jimmy? When we used to hang out
at Jibowu. Don't let's go to
okay, we don't want to go there.
You know what?
Then they'll be wondering, how? But they would say, you know big people. I don't know any big person. I know people who that became
not,
big.
And it's important that people know that when we were growing up, there were not too many people anyway.
I've known Donald Duke forever. Lamido Sanusi was my classmate. I mean, this Buki Saraski was my junior. They're people.
You get it.
you understand? So it's not too
big. But your classmate wants to go for presidency at some point, Saraki.
Saraki, my junior.
Was he your junior?
It was my junior. It was a year or two my junior. Saraki is a very sound mind.
Yeah,
let me be
no
honest
doubt.
With you.
Yeah.
He's a very exposed person.
Yeah.
He has the stature and charisma. He has the network. What I am a bit apprehensive of was what really happened in Kwara State. How he left Kwara State with such a dented image is what is my confusion.
I'm concerned.
And how he pushed the barriers and the borders of common politics and the aggressiveness. Let me use the word aggressiveness. And all that. That's what bothers me about Buki. And when I have time, I will engage.
What's happening to SLS though?
SLS has gone quiet.
It's gone very quiet.
He's gone to do a master's or something. And he's just taking life easy and breathing in.
Can you do me a favor? Can you drag him down here one of these days?
I will ask him.
Ask him.
He's not in town most of the time.
I'll go and meet him wherever he is.
Okay. I will ask him. He's gone quiet. He's decided to mind his business and focus on the things he would like to do and rest and think. When he's ready and when he thinks it's appropriate, he will share.
So are we going to send any President Itua in the making? You're a bit slightly above this governorship thing now, isn't it? What do you think?
I think so. I'm not interested in being I'm an elder statesman. I'm not ready. You know, I think.
And your experiment in Edo, was it successful? You know what I'm talking about.
Which experiment?
The experiment now. You, your brother, Edo citizens.
Which
the experiment
one?
That produced a governor. Not this one, no.
Which one? I'm totally lost and I don't want to say that.
Okay, I'll spare you that one. but you think you're happy with what is going on in Edo now, at least with what's his name?
Godwin is my brother. He and I are very close. He and Aswe are extremely close, and anybody knows that Aswe and I are one and the same. Godwin is a good guy, okay. He talks tough and he acts tough and he has the interests of people at heart. Okay. It's hard to make one or two compromises to survive in the political space. Okay.
One of which is changing parties.
Well, that was a desperate move, and it was a real desperate move. And in a way, when you talk technically and this and that, it wasn't what should have been done. But when you talk politically, it was a political masterstroke, okay? And God sort of backed him up, okay? Because he survived almost against all odds. But again, he proved the principle. He proved the principle. Oshomoletu is my friend.
What do you mean consider him your friend? When you talked about Godwin, you said you're close friend, but this one you say you consider him your friend.
Well, he's my friend.
Okay, so
he's
leave it at
friend.
That.
Let's leave that. Let's leave that. He's my friend.
I got to go. I got to go.
Yeah.
Well, we have to leave this. Where we'll knock it off for today. Thank you very much, Pastor Etua Godalu, for coming. And I hope you all enjoyed yourself. Sorry we couldn't take a lot of your comments and whatever, but keep the comments going on YouTube and Facebook. We're going to retweet so many things. Keep it going. We'll be back again on Tuesday. On Tuesday, I'm trying to get somebody in to teach us how to handle trauma. Okay? And we've had two major deaths now, and I think it's about time. And with the way the country is, I think it's about time we started taking lessons in how to handle trauma when we are faced with it. I got a message from somebody that shows that they have some records to show that there have been an increase in suicides amongst young people. And that is worrying. So we'll also be looking at these issues. So we'll be back again on Tuesday, 9 o'clock. Enjoy your weekend. Love thy neighbor as thyself as much as possible.
My pastor. Pastor Jimmy.
Nigeria Info. We are more than just radio. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at Nigeria Info FM. Check us out on Facebook at Nigeria Info 99.3. Follow us on Twitter at Nigeria Info FM and on Instagram at Nigeria Info FM Lagos for live updates as it happens. 99.3 Nigeria Info.